Now, vitamin D has also been shown, I said earlier, to regulate the immune system. And I mentioned autoimmune disease as a side effect of vitamin D deficit. And this goes back to what I was saying earlier about vitamin D being important for regulating the strength and the weakness of the immune cells. And so there have been a number of research studies that have shown autoimmune diseases like type 1 diabetes, rheumatoid arthritis, psoriatic arthritis, but also psoriasis, which they're both of those two fall kind of in the same category. So, and this is just a kind of a short list. It's not the comprehensive all-in, be-all, end-all list, but it is just a short list of different select autoimmune diseases that have been really well studied. Then we have cancer, and I mentioned this a minute ago, but vitamin D deficiency has been linked to 19 different forms of terminal types of cancer. So we don't want to play around with vitamin D. My advice to you, if you haven't ever had your vitamin D levels checked, look, when you go in and get your annual physical, get it checked. It's a simple test, simple blood test, 25-OHD. Ask your doctor to run 25-OHD. And if it's low, depending on where you live, depending on who you are, make sure either you're getting more sunshine without sunscreen, number one, or two, make sure that you're supplementing appropriately and have it rechecked periodically to make sure that supplementation is the right dose. Because I can't tell you how many times I've seen people that have come into me, they've been supplementing 6,000 units a day for, you know, a year, and their level didn't change. Their level didn't, it didn't budge, it didn't move. And there are a number of reasons why that can happen, which is why you want to have it objectively rechecked and reevaluated periodically. Don't just assume that the level's improving or going up because you're taking it. And, you know, sometimes it has to do with you know, what brand you're taking. Sometimes it has to do with other fillers or other ingredients in the product. Something else I want to mention that I haven't mentioned, and I just zoomed over it here, is that what you want to understand is that vitamin D is fat soluble. And the reason I'm bringing that up now, because I didn't mention this under the risks and I want to come back to it, is that it's a fat soluble vitamin, meaning that it's a fat, right? And so if we're talking about dietary vitamin D, I'm not talking about sunshine-based vitamin D, but dietary vitamin D. If you don't have a gallbladder, if you've had your gallbladder removed, if you've had a surgery, if you've got preexisting liver disease, and your gallbladder is not properly functioning, you run a greater risk of that diet vitamin D that you're eating through your diet not absorbing as effectively. So very important to understand that as well. If you've had gallbladder surgery, you know, it's just one more element of risk to add to what you need to understand about getting yourself measured. Now, there's also a list of medications that I want to bring up tonight that can cause vitamin D deficiency directly. So let's talk about what those are. The big one is corticosteroid. So if you take steroids for inflammation, if you take steroids for autoimmune disease, if you take steroids for inflammatory bowel disease, if you take steroids for any reason whatsoever, you should understand that taking steroids lowers your vitamin D. Period. It's been super well studied. There are a number of research studies that have confirmed this over the last many decades. Corticosteroids cause vitamin D deficiency. That's why one of the side effects of corticosteroid, chronic use of a steroid, and it's not just corticosteroids, it's steroids in general, that's why they cause osteoporosis, right? So think about this in terms of not just for pain, if you're taking steroids for pain, but think about it if you're using a steroid inhaler for asthma. Right? Think of it if you go in and you get periodic injections of a steroid in a knee joint or in a shoulder joint, or if you've had it in multiple joints, right? Stuff stays around in your body for months and months and months on end. So it's not just the injection and then the injection wore off a week later. It's that stuff stays in your body for a really long time and can cause a vitamin D deficit. So it's very important that you understand this. Now, antibiotics can also cause vitamin D deficiency. So can antifungals. So, you know, many of you, you know, category that strikes really hard here, those of you that maybe have been told you had Lyme disease and you've been on antibiotics for, you know, months and months, possibly even longer, you know, this is a risk factor for reducing your vitamin D. Same thing with antifungals. Those of you who've been told you had a yeast overgrowth and you've been put on, strong doses of prescription-based antifungal medications, these guys can cause vitamin D loss. Now, additionally, class of medications to treat seizures. So the anti-seizure meds can also cause vitamin D deficiency. So it's important, again, important that you know that, because if you're being prescribed them and if you're on them, you want to have the ability to have your doctor, while you're on them, monitor your D and possibly even supplement you with D during that time frame. So there are also some additional meds that can cause vitamin D loss, and that predominantly are the anti-cancer medication. So if you are taking, or if you're cancer and you are taking an anti-cancer agent, then that also can increase your risk for vitamin D deficiency. Hey, don't forget to check out the rest of the series right here. Make sure you hit subscribe below. And as always, thanks for tuning in.